one C three at that time?
Yes. The website was one of the last thing, or one of the last things we had.
Do you have your number?
He's got his papers right here, I'm passing down.
The tax information, the state information is coming down.
But now, you said it's been dissolved.
The board has stated their intent to dissolve the nonprofit, yes.
And that's a segue, just to catch everybody up, I had it as an exhibit, and this is an email that I got as chair. And it's the board exhibit that I gave you guys copies of.
So when the board of directors was appointed by who?
I selected the board members, asked them if they would become board members.
Okay.
And they were voted in by the board itself.
Okay, so that, and that was for the 501 C three?
Correct.
That board of directors has decided to dissolve that 501 C three?
Correct.
Ms. Wilder, I can read the email I got from the board.
Okay, I can read all that, I'm just trying to get a timeline here.
Right. The board.
When was it dissolved?
March 23rd, 2019 is, I don't
have confirmation that the organization has been dissolved as of.
They have dissolved their relationship with Mr. Taylor as of March 23rd, 2019.
Go ahead and read the letter, okay?
That's why.
I understand, okay.
So April 26th, 2019, I got an email from Kelly Zarcone, who is the secretary for sheep.rnr. "Mr. Luna, this email is to let you and your board know with respect to the above matter that Mr. John Taylor has been removed from any authority over sheep.rnr even by the board and may not bind the organization or make representative in any way. This is effective as of 3/23/2019. Any matters pending, please advise the undersigned, thank you for your purposes." Now I responded, "Ms. Zarcone, thank you for your correspondence. I will advise my board. Currently, there's a hearing set for May 28th at 6:30 to determine two things. One, whether sheepdog is suitably operated commercial in scenarios on agricultural, and two, the answer is yes to whether sheepdog is grandfathered in or whether sheepdog needs to apply for special exception. Please advise as to whether your company will continue to be represented with this facility or whether our board needs to correspond with Mr. Taylor about the project in his individual capacity." And they responded that he does not, Mr. Taylor does not represent sheep.rnr in any capacity. Sheep.rnr leases the premises for Mr. Taylor, and the board should.
Say that again, who is responding to this?
The secretary of sheep.rnr, Kelly Zarcone.
So sheep.rnr still exists, but has dissolved its relationship with Mr. Taylor?
Yes, and personally, yes. And so my understanding is, as of this, my understanding from these emails is that they have a lease. They lease the property from Mr. Taylor, and Mr. Taylor owns the property. I don't know the status of that, and also, quite frankly, our board's determination is use and what the use has been and what the use intends to be. It's not a determination. I mean, of course, factors can come into play, but the objective analysis of this board is whether it's under Mr. Taylor's name or whether it's under Sheepdog's name or whether it's under John Boy's name or whoever's name is relevant. It's what are they operating, what is the nature of the operation. And so, you know, bringing this to the attention of the board is merely for informational purposes as far as the relationship that Mr. Taylor has currently with sheep.rnr, as far as any inquiries to the reasoning behind it. Ms. Zarcone didn't offer, and quite frankly, I didn't ask because it's not relevant to our analysis.
Well, it could be relevant. We're not at the point to determine whether it's relevant or not.
Correct.
We need a timeline. So the 501 C three that is sheepdog belonged to the board of directors, actually. Were you on the board?
I was the founder and the president. I resigned in April.
Okay, so
when did the lease go?
The lease went into effect April of last year.
April of 18?
April 18, correct. Five-year triple net lease.
It was a five-year lease. When you started the lease in April, what activity has been conducted on the property since April 2018? What have you done?
We've had guests out for some overnight stays. We've had some guests out for day visits. For example, we had representatives from another nonprofit in the county, OPT on horses. I don't know if you've heard of them or not, but they walked through on 21st of January to look at areas of mutual cooperation. We had a donor provide donations of volunteer time on the 9th of February, and that occurred for approximately a week. She stayed at the Cannon County Inn during her stay. Had a visitor from Chattanooga on the 12th of May. Came up just to enjoy some peace and quiet woods. One visitor
this is all in 2018?
Correct.
Okay, so why were these visitors coming to your property?
To relax, to get away from the city.
So they were guests of yours.
The stressors.
Did you charge them for it?
No.
Okay.
That's the premise of the organization. We don't charge our members and our guests.
It's based on donations from others.
Correct.
So when you started your 501(c)(3), did you have is there a mission statement?
There is a mission statement. It should be on the website page.
Have y'all passed that to Ms. Wilding with those things?
One more thing I'll pass down is the GuideStar rating board. We had a platinum rating from GuideStar, which rates nonprofits of all sizes. And that is from the end of June of last year when that rating was established. Yeah. So the numbers on there for a number of guests that we had, the number of guests that we trained in skills reflects the July 2017 through June of 2018.
Mr. Taylor, your relationship with Sheepdog has been settled.
Correct.
Since that relationship was severed, have you been just business as usual?
The mission as stated for Sheepdog continues without the organization. That's something I told the board when we went public with Cannon Courier that we were doing this last year.
When did you go public with the Courier?
It was approximately May, June of last year. I meant to bring a copy of that paper. I don't have it with me. But it was publicized in the paper. That was when we met all the criteria that the board put on me before we go public, of having the website, having the 501(c)(3) status up, and having all of our forms correct before we went public.
Absolutely. Mr. Taylor, what type of activities go on your property here in typical?
During typical visits?
Yes.
Generally, it's going to be the veteran and his guests, it's family members that he brings with him, or myself, sitting around a campfire, grilling, have a couple beers. Depending on what they want to do, we do others. So, if they're into antiques, we're going to bring them downtown to the antique store.
I'm really only concerned with what takes place on the
property. Okay.
Just for
on the property, it's going to be some agricultural pursuits of either tending to trees and fruit trees and berries and such, or hiking in the woods, going back to the waterfalls that they trespass to, and that kind of
thing. Any licensed position?
No.
These retreats.
And I would like to address that. It was brought up by a couple of people. This is not a mental health facility. Not at all. The requirements for our members is that they show proof of honorable service in firefighting, paramedic services, police services, or military service. Not that they be mentally unstable.
What's the typical group size?
Typical group size? 1-3.
And do typically multiple groups come at the same time?
In the future, we may have that when we have our cabins up, and we have a veteran in two or three cabins at the same time.
So you have cabins on the property?
We don't have cabins on the property.
Hey, just one final question. When did you start bringing groups out to your property?
Our first visitors officially were probably around January of 2018.
You got any documentation on that?
I got my calendar, I got it marked. It's sort of like the judge that went through the hearings in Washington. Triple H is who feeds it on arts.
Their Facebook page had pictures from around, I'm going to say, April or May 2018 of people there, and they had sheepdog or shirts on, because there were shirts in that. The Facebook page was taken down.
So what did you say about trees?
I can open up that Facebook group back up to you. I tried to get onto it today to put it back in the open format, but I didn't get to the settings page to find that. It's not gone away. It's went to a secret group because I've had a few people, not in this room, but I have a few people that are causing problems.
So you said when you were answering Mr. Lee's questions, you said something, they do something with trees? What do they do
trees,
with trees?
Fruit trees, taking care of fruit trees, picking fruit to eat for themselves. We're not talking them logging. As a matter of fact, the trees on the property are not ready to be logged, and they won't be ready to be logged for another 20, 30 years. One thing Ms. Melton had said was loud trucks. And I was really having a hard time figuring out what she was talking about until Mr. King got up and mentioned the mulch trucks. That is the contractor for MTMC, and yes, they are dropping wood chips. And that is to improve the grounds so we don't have things growing in the power right away, which is the area that it was clear was the area for the electric lines.
So that has nothing to do with your operations?
Other than I'm going to use that mulch to keep things from growing? No. That is not part of the sheepdog or mission operations. Oh, I appreciate free mulch. I try to work with as many.
So is there the mulch in an electric place, sir?
I'm sorry?
Is there you said
MTMC, Middle Tennessee Electric.
Middle Tennessee Electric.
When they put the electric in, they have a 20-foot right-of-way on either side of their line. That.
So the mulch is going on the easement, too?
Partially, yes. So around the poles. The places that I don't want them to have to cut every 2 years. And I don't want them to spray Roundup on it every 2 years. So I need to get that part under control to where it's not a problem for them.
I'm looking at your summary of financial activities of charitable organization. It says accounting period date June 30th, 2018. It's got your FBI number. It says your gross revenue was $5,139.88.
Correct. That would be for the first fiscal year. That was primarily from April until June of that year.
Do you recall? And then for 2017, it was $24,174 in contribution.
That should have been 2000. You look at the IRS return.
Mm-hmm.
The $24,000 includes $16,000 in tractors. I donated to the organization.
Okay, that's awesome.
So, yeah.
Okay. And your fund balance at the end of 6/30/2018 is $28,104.
That includes the tractors. That doesn't include, that's a lot more of it in tractors than cash.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, but we have to keep under control what you're leading.
Yeah, just one more question. What's the largest group you've had at one time?
The largest group at one time? To date, probably 3 or 4.
Okay.
In the future, you know, there will be some that are larger than that, but there are a few different things going on, and part of it's a legal matter for the commission, and then some are just good neighbor things. And I want to stress that just because it's not by law that certain things, certain concerns, are, which are valid, can't be stopped by the commission, doesn't mean I'm not going to address it. Traffic is probably the biggest challenge, and yes, I have a plan in place to prevent a lot of traffic from coming through your neighborhood. ATVs, you can ask your neighbors. I have stopped ATVs trespassing my property.
You are talking to them.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
So, I'm not sure it's clear to me what your purpose is, your mission. It just sounds like it's a respite for people to go who meet your criteria.
Correct.
Without rules, because you don't want it to be military. You say that you want it to be for veterans with no military, with nothing like the military. So no.
Used to refer to General Order Number 1 as "Thou shalt not have fun."
Uh-huh.
Is it no alcohol? No. No sex, no poker, no gambling. Anything that might be fun was banned.
So, when this was became a 501(c)(3), see a sheepdog, and I see your board of directors. The board of directors itself elected to dissolve sheepdog, correct?
They have expressed their intent to dissolve it. They have not verified that they have dissolved it.
Okay, but you are still going under the name Sheepdog?
No, ma'am, I'm not.
You're not?
No, ma'am.
What is your organization now?
Right now, we are known as Protectors R&R. I have
changed. Say that again?
Protectors.
Protectors.
That is not necessarily the final name of the organization, but to differentiate it from the 501(c)(3), that is what we are using.
So do you have 501(c)(3) set up for Protectors R&R?
No.
No, okay.
That will be established on a for-profit, not a non-for-profit basis, as an individual pursuit, not a corporate.
So it will be a for-profit, not a not-for-profit?
Yep. Legally speaking, yes. It will be ran as a non-profit, but it will be taxed as a for-profit. Does that make sense?
I still struggle with Sheepdog. Leases the property. What property are you using? Do you have Sheepdog permission to use their property?
It's my property.
Not based on the lease.
They have expressed an interest in ending the lease. They just have not given me a date that they want to terminate it. If they do not give me a date soon, I will give them eviction notice. And they'll have 10 days leave to back vacant, which is according to their lease that they wrote.
Is Robert White still the chairman, or was the chairman when?
I believe he is currently serving as president.
Okay, I thought you were president.
No, I resigned in April.
He's not part of Sheepdog.
He's not part of Sheepdog.
Sheepdog severed their relationship with him.
But he plans on using that property for potentially a profit, a for-profit organization.
But still have an active lease with Sheepdog.
No, Sheepdog will be completely gone.
He's talking about Sheepdog going away, which clarifies the entire thing in my mind.
Right. Okay. Okay. Need for profit. Okay.
Any other questions for Mr. Lowe?
But I do appreciate you.
Thank you.
Coming.
Thank you very much.
All right. Appreciate you.
I know if I could address.
Hold on a second. Let me call it for a
okay. I just wanted to ask Ms. Melton a question.
Okay.
off, I think, three times now, and I believe, if I'm not mistaken, there were other people here. Okay, are you the collective voice of the subdivision? Are you the only ones that are concerned?
We're not the only ones that are concerned, but you have to realize that our subdivision is mainly made up of the working population.
I understand.
And most of them, I know some of them took off work the last time.
Right.
To be here.
I know, I know.
And we had family issues and other things like that come up, so, and like I said.
Well, I knew that I had seen other faces here.
There's several of them that are like myself, that have really young kids, and if my husband hadn't been off work, I wouldn't be here, because I wouldn't have nobody to watch them.
Okay, thank you. You had something you wanted to say?
I'd like to say that, I've been here twice now, and I, of course, I'll put it, kept putting it off. And these other people, they forget, like I almost did, and,
That's why I wanted to ask, because I know I've been here, and I know that for the very first meeting, literally, you waited for hours. And I was number one, and I know that Mr. Newman has apologized over and over. But that's why I wanted to ask, because I'm not seeing some faces that I've seen before. That's all I said.
There are about five faces that I have seen at prior meetings that I haven't seen.
Okay, that's what I was.
So there are.
And I didn't know if they were with Mr. Taylor or, okay.
There, Mr. Taylor had one individual with him the first time, and then between the first time and the last time and this time, there's probably about five or four or five faces that I've seen and probably ones that I haven't seen here. So I think it would be fair to say that it's a concern by a large member of.
I wanted to be fair to the citizens because we have put it off, so.
Right.
Thank you.
And so, we're at the discussion part. And before we get discussion, Tom, do you have any thoughts on this?
I do. Do you want to hear?
I think we probably do want to hear your thoughts.
Yeah. Of course, I've got to base everything that I have come up with on that everybody's telling the truth.
Yeah.
And so if everybody's telling the truth, to me, it seems like this was an operation before our zoning ordinance was adopted. He stated that he had had people there since January of 2018. I don't know that we have any way to disprove this. Mr. Luna said he even saw it on a Facebook page. People were out there and sheepdogging on our t-shirts. And I also don't think, even if he wasn't grandfathered in, I don't feel like this is I think this would be permitted use in A1. People can't, as of right now. Now, he talks about future things that he wants to do, but we can't make our decision based on that. We have to make our decision based upon the current use of what it is right now. And that's my opinion. It seems like it's grandfathered in. It's unfortunate that his use of the property seems to be at odds with his neighbors. But that's just based on, that's how I see it. I'd certainly answer any questions to tell you how, you know, I came to that conclusion.
You came to it the same way that I did, quite frankly. I do think that this is a business operating in A1 agricultural zone, tax or commercial revenue generated. There's revenue generated by this business. That would make it a commercial use. An A1 agricultural use is permitted or agricultural uses in single family residential structures and accessory structures. Uses permitted upon appeal. All uses not specifically permitted, which means anybody can appeal to ask for a use. I think it is and again, unless there's somebody that can impeach somebody's statement and show that somebody's lying, I have in front of me financial activities and charitable organization for June 30th, 2018. Zoning was August 16th, 2018, and it shows $5,139.88 in public contributions, $2,250 in program expenses, a tax return for 2017 with the address of Sheepdog at that time, whose property being Mr. Taylor's property is at, of contribution gifts, grants, and similar amounts received, $24,174. Mr. Taylor stated that his lease began April 2018 with Sheepdog owner. He had people there in 2018. And in May or June, there was an article in the paper announcing it. And so, looking at this objective, our mandate as a Board of Zoning Appeals is to determine whether a business is operating in violation of the zoning ordinance. It is my opinion that Mr. Taylor is running a commercial business in violation of the zoning ordinance. However, it's also my opinion that he is grandfathered in. He has substantial proof through tax returns, through tax records, through statements of other people in the community about the traffic. And the traffic is a practical concern, and the traffic should be a practical. But those types of concerns, in my opinion, are beyond, you know, they're beyond what we can address or can't address as this board. And I have an asphalt plant across from my subdivision that I can't do anything about, Joe. Nobody is more empathetic to bad neighbors than I am. I am not, my thought is not Mr. Taylor's a good neighbor. I don't know whether he's a good neighbor or not. My hope is that he is and that he will be. But as far as the purpose of discussion, I think that it's grandfathered in.
I believe he's grandfathered in. He is not in violation of the ordinance. He is not conforming. Not conforming meaning he's got use and he's not committed. Today, because of ordinance, I agree. He's not in violation. He is just not conforming.
I agree. That's exactly what I think. I think that he is not conforming. He's grandfathered in.
Well, I will be the dissenting vote. I don't agree.
Okay.
I believe when Sheepdog is no longer in, is no longer supporting this, it's no longer a part of Sheepdog, and it doesn't apparently hold the same mission as Sheepdog, because he says he's going for profit. It's not a 501c3. That completely changes the game, and it does. We go from a 501c3 to a for profit.
Not under our zoning ordinance, it doesn't change the game at all.
It will.
Yeah,
I challenge that. I've read it too. You're not going to convince me otherwise. I will be a dissenting vote. I don't agree.
Boy, appreciate.
I don't agree.
Mr. Brandon?
I too live across that asphalt plant, so I'm...
You understand.
I understand, but I do believe it's a technicality. It's a technicality, and the fact that it is no longer Sheepdog R&R, that none of the main principles is not a 501c3, so it's therefore not the business. We have seen no, and I worked for long enough, and God, you trust everybody else, I want documentation. If he had people that are visiting, I want dates, I want names, I want, I'm sorry.